I'm Ben, and this is Hyperfine, resources and tutorials for architects by architects. Today I'm talking about the ARE 5.0, PPD and PDD exams. I'm sharing four things you need to know going into test day. I'll be talking about some basic structures, some structural material properties, vapor barriers, and solar orientation. I took these two exams, about 10 days apart. I think the general consensus is that they have a lot of overlapping material, so it's good to study for them and take them close together. And so today I'm sharing four things that I think you need to know going into test day. If you saw my first video, that was more of a test and study strategy and pep talk. This one, I'm talking four actual facts you need to know going into the test, including the only four structural formulas I actually had memorized going into the exam. If you like these videos, please hit like and subscribe. Check out Hyperfine Architecture for more free resources, and definitely leave a comment if there's something you want me to cover next. Let's get started. Okay. Number one is F equals M over S. This is one equation you need to understand. It's the first one listed in the ARE 5.0 handbook, and it's one of four that I actually did know going into the exam, and I was tested on it multiple times. And what it says is F equals M over S. F is the allowable bending stress is equal to the maximum moment divided by the section modulus. Or more simply, the maximum stress is equal to the force trying to bend the beam divided by how strong the beam is. It's important to know that you're probably not just going to get this equation handed to you straight up and then given the formula, given the variables, and just plug them in, right? You're probably going to be given a word problem or maybe shown a diagram and have to know that that's what you have to use. But let's talk about what this means and how to solve it. Basically, you want to limit the stress in your system. And so to do that, you have two options. You can either decrease the moment or you can increase the section modulus. The maximum bending moment, like I said, is the force trying to bend your beam. There are formulas for M itself. So there's formulas within formulas. The two main ones, and I also had these memorized, were WL squared over 8 for a simple beam with a uniform load, and PL over 4 for a simple beam with a point load. This image right here is from Architectural Graphic Standards. But if you Google these, they're all over the internet. So you should be familiar with these from Structures 101, your basic free body diagram stuff. So that's your uniform distributed load. Here's your point load. And I did not have this one memorized, but that would have been nice. This is a load on a cantilever beam. So that's the moment. We'll get back to that. The next part is your section modulus. So this is the strength of the beam due to its cross-section, due to the shape and how much material is in the beam. So our options for decreasing stress, again, are to decrease the moment or increase the section modulus. So let's talk about how we will do these things. We'll start with the moment. So if we get a typical sort of floor system, this is a complete generic thing I just made up with the weights and everything, but if we've got beams at 10 feet on center, basically, this shaded area is the tributary area. It's how much weight is going to that beam, right? So 5 feet on this side of the beam and 5 feet on that side of the beam, and it's got a 20-foot span. So if we solve for M, and again, you're probably not going to have to actually do the calculations. You just have to understand how this works. If you solve for M, you get a moment of 15,000 foot-pounds. So if we want to decrease M from our base condition, the first option we could do is to add more beams. So instead of having them at 10 feet on center, we put them at 5 feet on center. And you see now how greatly that tributary area is reduced, how much less weight is going to the beam. So instead of 5 feet on each side for a total of 10, now we get 2.5 feet on each side for a total of 5 feet, and we have halved the moment, right? So in our base equation, F equals M over S, we've now reduced M by half. The other thing we could do, instead of just reducing the weight, is we can reduce the length. And so we do that with putting some type of support midspan. So instead of the beams trying to span that whole 20-foot length, now the part of the beam subjected to bending is only 10 feet, right? So the tributary area becomes a lot smaller. If we plug all this into the equation, we see now we're down to 3,500 foot-pounds. Basically because we've added a support halfway through and have that length. So those are two methods of reducing M, right? From our base equation, everything we talked about right now is just focused on reducing the moment right there. So now we talk about section modulus. And There are section modulus formulas. I almost had this memorized, but I was wrong about it and end up not needing to use it anyway. These are from Wikipedia right here, but I don't think you actually have to know these equations. You have to understand how you would get a bigger section modulus. So if we look in that flooring system I made up a minute ago, basically you're going to have a choice between a taller beam or a smaller and heavier beam. So let's say your baseline beam that you're given is a W12x14. Remember, your W flanges are, if it's a W12x14, that means it's about 12 inches tall and it's about 14 pounds per linear foot. So you can take a heavier beam of basically the same size. So a W12 is also going to be about a foot tall, and it's going to be 26 pounds per linear foot. And because it's got that extra weight, it's got more steel, more material in it, it's going to have a higher section modulus. Or you could potentially get a shorter beam that's a lot heavier. And this W10/60, even though it's only 10 inches tall, it's 60 pounds per linear foot. There's a lot more steel in there. There's a lot more weight, so it's going to have a higher section modulus. I think that's the level of understanding you really need to have on these exams. You could have a taller beam that might be less expensive, but it's going to give you a greater floor-to-floor height. Or you could have a shorter beam that is going to be more expensive, but it's going to save you on floor-to-floor height. So I'm not a structural engineer, obviously, and neither are you guys, but that is the level of understanding you need to have of this equation going into PPD and PDD. Okay, number two, vapor barriers. This is a topic that's definitely going to be on the exam. And this is a complex topic, but on the ARE, what you really need to know is that the vapor barrier will go on the warm side. And how do you know what the warm side is? If you get a question about this, you should be able to definitively identify the climate as hot or cold. So Texas versus Wisconsin, or Florida versus Maine. Here you see the climate zones in the 2015 IECC. I'll put the link in the description. You should be familiar with this diagram though. And I know it gets hot in Wisconsin, which is in the north, and it can get cold in Texas, which is in the south. But these are examples of states that are obviously north and obviously south. The vapor barrier needs to go on the warm side. So in the south, that means the outside, right? It basically needs to go on the warm side because moisture will be more prevalent in warm air, and we don't want to get that moisture getting trapped in the wall as the temperature decreases. If we look at a section of a generic wall, you can see if it's 90 degrees outside and it's 70 degrees inside, this outdoor air is hotter and has more moisture. And as we travel through your wall system, the temperature begins to drop. It goes down a little bit over your exterior cladding. It'll not do much over if you have a air cavity. It'll go down a little bit over your sheathing. It'll go down a lot when you have actual insulation until it finally reaches your indoor air temperature. And if the temperature is going from 90 to 70 and say the dew point's at 80, that means the dew point is going to happen probably somewhere in your wall system, and you don't want that moisture getting trapped in there. So like I said, this is complex. In actual practice, you want a vapor retarder so that any moisture that's in your wall system can dry out. As far as the ARE is concerned, you really just want to put the moisture barrier, the vapor barrier, on the warm side. So here's a little example. We've got five choices. Number one is wrong because it's on the interior. Number four and five are exterior, but they don't make sense. You have to know enough that you aren't putting your vapor barrier on your exterior finish or in your air gap. And so three obviously makes the most sense because that's on the warm side of your insulation. It's not in the insulation. And over your sheathing is where your vapor barrier most typically will go in a warm climate. Number three, solar orientation for passive heating. On the ARE, the most correct orientation for a building will be long in the east-west axis. So long in this direction with a flat surface facing south. This is because there's more southern exposure during the day, and it's better exposure, meaning we can more easily control the sun that we allow access into our building. If we look at this section, we can see these red lines represent the altitude of the sun, the height of the sun on June 21st. That's its highest point of the year in Washington, D.C. And if it's facing south, it's very easy to add an overhang above your window that is set to a correct distance to block all that sun from hitting your glazing. So that's a lot of heat that you're protecting from not entering your building that you don't have to mechanically cool. That same overhang, you can see, is shallow enough that it doesn't block these winter sun. So these blue lines represent the altitude of the winter sun on December 21st here in Washington, D.C. as well. So you can see that just represents a bunch of free heat coming into your building. I'm going to be doing a Revit tutorial on this soon, how I figured this out, how you can model different methods of solar shading. But for the ARE, it's enough to know that you want to maximize your southern exposure on the south face and limit your east-west exposure. If you do have to add some shading on the east and the west facades, vertical fins are more effective than horizontal overhangs. So here in the south, you get horizontal overhangs. On the east and the west, you can use vertical fins. They're not as effective, though, as this southern shading. Okay, here's another equation I had memorized going to the test, and I didn't end up using it or seeing it on any of my exams, but I still think it's valuable to know, and this is the deflection formula for maximum deflection. What this is basically your code limit for how much a floor system can bend, right? So if we look at, this is the IBC chapter 16, usually see it in the code as a value over 360, right? So this is your deflection formula. And it looks complex, but it's actually pretty easy. So the first thing we're going to do, basically 5 and 384 are constants. You can't change them. So if we just look at the formula without those, we get WL to the fourth over EI. And again, if we want to limit deflection, we have to either decrease the top half of the formula or increase the bottom half of the formula. So the top half is W and L, weight and length. So just like in our moment equation, we can either reduce the tributary area or reduce, in some other way, reduce the weight of the system that's going onto each beam. Or we can reduce the length by reducing the span. You see this, the length is to the fourth, so that number gets really high very quickly. So if you can add some support mid-span, you're going to greatly reduce your deflection. The bottom half, we have EI. These are two values of the strength of a structural member. E is based on its material, and I is based on its shape. So let's look at these. E is your modulus of elasticity. You might have seen this chart. I got this from Wikipedia. You don't have to at all memorize this, but basically, I think it's the point at which a material gets strained and that it won't return to its initial shape. The two key values that you need to be aware of is that wood has a modulus of elasticity of about 1.6 million, and steel is about 29 million. Wood, you can see it anywhere from like 1.3, some engineered products like LVLs, I think, are around 2, maybe even a little bit higher. But the key difference is that, you know, wood is in this sort of like 1.6 range, and steel is pretty constant at 29 million. So if you want to increase the bottom half of that initial equation, going from wood to steel is going to really strengthen up your system. Of course, that's not always an option. So now let's cover I, moment of inertia. And this is a value of strength of your beam based on its shape. I've got a great video on this that I can link to down in the description. But basically, if this is the center axis of your beam, the more of the material that is further away from that center axis, the higher your moment of inertia is going to be. So if you've got a rectangular shaped beam, it's got a lot of material in there, but it doesn't have a huge moment of inertia. Your typical W flange is going to have a higher moment of inertia because you sort of get rid of all this material in the middle that's not really doing much for you, and concentrate the material at the ends where you're going to have your highest forces, your tension and compression are highest. And if you make that beam even taller, you get more material even further away from the center line. This one will have the highest moment of inertia. And again, you might sort of have to understand this in a general sense, like you want to limit the deflection. This beam will be a lot better than this beam, but this one is going to give you a lot greater floor to floor height, which you might not be able to have in your building. You know, it might end up costing you a whole story, which you can't have. So again, deflection formula, 5 WL to the fourth over 384 EI. You're not going to have to probably plug in values, but understanding how this works and what your variables are will really help you on the exam. And that's it. Four things I think you need to know that'll help you out with PDD and PPD exams. Make sure to check out the description below. I'm going to put a lot of links to different online resources I found and used in this video. And definitely leave a comment if there's something you want me to cover next. And check out hyperfinearchitecture.com for more resources. Good luck. Thanks for watching.